Hello, and welcome to the 2021 In-Demand Jobs Week celebration at Columbus State. This evening will feature a diversity and technology panel conversation featuring 8 different industry panelists, and we'll have a couple of presentations about opportunities to get involved in technology fields through Columbus State. It is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce John Husted, the current Lieutenant Governor for the state of Ohio. He serves as director of both Innovate Ohio and the Governor's Office of Workforce Transformation, as well as oversees the Common Sense Initiative, or CSI Ohio. The Lieutenant Governor began his life in foster care before being adopted by his parents, Jim and Judy Husted, and raised in Northwest Ohio. He earned a bachelor's degree in education and a master's degree in communications, both from the University of Dayton. While an undergrad at UD, he was an All-American defensive back for the Dayton Flyers and a member of the school's 1989 National Championship football team. Lieutenant Governor Husted has spent the majority of his career working on economic and workforce development issues, starting in the Ohio-Miami Valley area as the Vice President for Economic Development for the Dayton Area Chamber of Commerce. He served as a member of both the Ohio Senate and the Ohio House of Representatives, including 4 years as Speaker of the House. He also served as Secretary of State, where he transformed operations, resulting in his ability to run the office for the final 2 years of his term without using any tax dollars. Of all his responsibilities, he considers his most important roles to be that of husband to his wife, Tina, and father to his children, Alex, Katie, and Kylie. Please join me in welcoming the Lieutenant Governor of the state of Ohio, John Husted.
Hello, I'm John Husted, Ohio's Lieutenant Governor. I want to thank the students, businesses, families, and educators in attendance today. Technology careers are in demand in Ohio, and we're excited to be at this event during In-Demand Jobs Week. Technology impacts every industry, and we know businesses across Ohio are looking for workers with the right kinds of skills. Conversations like today's are important because Ohio's workforce is diverse, and there are a variety of ways to get where you want to go. I want to encourage the future Columbus State students in the audience to take full advantage of the opportunities that are being offered in today's discussions. Thank you, Dr. Harrison, for having me today, and I wish you all great success in the future of your education.
Thank you so much, Lieutenant Governor Husted. It is now my distinct pleasure to introduce Columbus State Community College President, Dr. David T. Harrison. Dr. David T. Harrison became the 5th president of Columbus State Community College in July 2010. With more than 46,000 students, Columbus State is one of the largest and most comprehensive colleges in the state of Ohio. The college's focus on student success through partnerships has resulted in recognition as 2019 Leah Meyer Austin Award winner through the National Community College Advocacy Network, Achieving the Dream. Since 2010, Columbus State has more than tripled its graduation rate and has significantly closed performance gaps for low-income students and students of color. Its 2019 graduating class was the largest and most diverse in the college's history. Under Dr. Harrison's leadership, Columbus State has developed deep relationships with regional universities to create affordable bachelor's degree pathways through innovative 2+2 and 3+1 partnerships. The college has expanded access to post-secondary opportunities to high school students, serving more than 7,000 high school students annually, and has collaborated with employers to develop innovative solutions for regional workforce needs. As an established proving ground for public-private partnerships, Columbus State has brought together social service organizations, employers, and local and state federal agencies to create outcomes benefiting students, families, and communities. Dr. Harrison came to Columbus State with extensive experience building successful community partnerships. As Vice Provost for Regional Campuses at the University of Central Florida, he worked with community colleges to create the Central Florida Higher Education Consortium and the nationally recognized Direct Connect to UCF program, which guarantees the opportunity for a bachelor's degree for graduates of partner community colleges. Prior to joining UCF, Dr. Harrison served in leadership roles at Seminole State College in Florida and at Sinclair Community College in Ohio. And he was a consulting manager with Accenture in Pittsburgh. He holds a PhD from The Ohio State University, an MBA from Katz Graduate School of Business at the University of Pittsburgh, and a bachelor's degree in chemical engineering from the University of Dayton. Please join me in welcoming Columbus State Community College President, Dr. David T. Harrison.
Thank you, Tom. Hi, everybody. It's good to be with you. One of the pandemic practices that we've adopted at Columbus State is to start every meeting with gratitude. And that's my role here today. I want to start by thanking the Lieutenant Governor for his opening remarks and for being such a huge champion for in-demand jobs week and workforce innovation generally. There's no greater supporter strategic alignment of education and the high-performing workplace, the innovative workplace, than Lieutenant Governor Husted. Thank you so much, Lieutenant Governor, for being here. I want to thank all the students and parents and faculty from both college and K-12 and employers for being part of this. We love these kinds of convenings, even if they're virtual, where we're bringing everybody together to work towards a similar opportunity for our students and for our region to grow. I want to give special gratitude to our panel. This focus on diversity is critical, certainly to Columbus State, but as employers really start to rethink career paths, really start to rethink credentials, and the process of career growth, the panel that we have is really going to show a lot of different perspectives, a lot of creative opportunities for students from all walks of life to access really good jobs and high growth, sustainable careers. After the panel, I really hope that our students and prospective students stick around to hear the many options that are available to access these great career opportunities. We've got, really through partnerships with employers, we've got different levels of engagement opportunities for students from, again, all walks of life. Some who are coming directly from high school, others who are working in another field and looking to transition. Our partnerships with employers now really give opportunities for students that just didn't exist even a few years ago. And one of those students that's taking full advantage of those opportunities is Garrett Braxton, who's a student at Columbus State, who is going to moderate the panel. Garrett is also part of our internship program with State Auto in information technology. We're delighted to have him here. So I'm happy to turn it over to Garrett Braxton.
Thank you, Dr. Harrison. And thank you so much for being here this evening. Moderated by Columbus State student Garrett Braxton, a veteran and currently working with State Auto as an IT flexible apprentice, the panel discussion, Diversity in Technology, begins now.
Hello, everyone. My name is Garrett Braxton, as they said, and I'll be your moderator for today's panel discussion. So today we have eight amazing professionals actively contributing in the world of information technology. So I have a little bit of a unorthodox journey that got me here to Columbus State and State Auto. So 3 years ago, actually today, I was deployed to Afghanistan, or as we call it, studying abroad. And I'd spent Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, all in a foxhole or in a guard tower, essentially not sure if I was going to make it to the next day. And so while I was doing all of this, you know, you don't really think of your future there. You're kind of just surviving. And as I got back to the States, I really took a hard look at, you know, getting up there in age and really trying to figure out what I wanted to do and what interests me. I'm so glad that I decided to take this journey. And it's been by far the most rewarding thing to receive my diploma on Friday or in the coming weeks, and to actually be working on production code at State Auto, where I'm doing a lot of things with working with AWS and their pipelines. And it's just been so surreal that, you know, like I said, 3 years ago, I was in the desert. So with that being said, I would like to take the time to, if all of the guests here could introduce themselves and give a quick 15-minute rundown, and we'll get right on started. So how about we start with Tammy on the line, and we'll go from there.
Okay. Well, congratulations to you on graduating and your degree. So my name is Tammy Murray. I am a software engineer with Accenture, particularly Accenture Federal Services. And I basically work under the SAP platform. So I was a computer science major and an MIS minor from UNC Charlotte. And I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
So Erica, if you would take over from there, please.
Absolutely. My name is Erica Rivera, and I'm so proud of you, Garrett. Thank you so much for representing State Auto so well. I'm also a partner at State Auto. I call myself partners because we're all in this together. But I am specifically in culture and inclusion, and you're probably wondering, well, why are you on this IT panel? Well, I cut my teeth in recruitment and leading a team of recruiters who recruited for IT. So very happy to be here with you today and very proud of you, Garrett.
Jermaine.
Good evening. And again, congratulations, Garrett. Very, very good to hear your story. And I can certainly relate. You talked about how you arrived at the decision to come into IT. When I was a young kid, I had a thing with technology. And I remember I got myself in some pretty big trouble taking apart the VCR. And I'm telling my age with that story. But I took apart a VCR because I was fascinated with the technology. Which has kind of led me to where I am today. So I work at Nationwide. I'm a vice president in application development, where we drive software engineering best practices across all of our development teams. And that includes multiple technology stacks, even legacy mainframe, all the way to our AWS services in the cloud. And I'm very happy to be here to represent today.
Brandon, if you would introduce yourself, please.
Brandon Jones here. I'm an ecosystem builder, co-founder of a few verticals, Black Hack and Venture Suite. Overall, been in the space for probably about 5 years, just getting people of color to break into tech and find ways to advance their careers.
All right. And Carla, if we could start with you, please.
Absolutely. So excited to be up here with all of you. My name is Carla Easley, and I am the Director of Operations for TechCorps. We are a national nonprofit organization that is headquartered here in Columbus, and we really hone in on providing computer science and IT opportunities for K-12 students. And like Erica said, I'm just happy to be invited to the party because I don't work directly in IT or computer science, but I've spent my life's work empowering, and educating the young, you know, innovators of the world who will, you know, ultimately be game changers for us all. So that is my connection to this arena.
Well, great. And we're happy to have you. And I've heard a couple times people saying that they're not directly in IT, but it's such a far-reaching industry, like you said. And so I would consider you involved in the industry as well, Carlo.
Thank you, Garrett. I appreciate that. And yes. Congratulations to you as well.
Thank you. So, Doug, if we could continue with you, please.
Hello, everybody. So I'm Doug McCullough. I am a chief information officer, and in my career, I've been an IT director and a chief information officer and a project manager. I have been working mostly in public sector. I've worked for two cities and four state of Ohio agencies. Have a degree in information systems and operations management from the University of Toledo, but then also an MBA from the University of Notre Dame. So I'm a bit of a unicorn with tech, business, and government. I also do a lot of work in the community with startups, and I'm beginning to be more engaged with them. I work for the city of Dublin, but I also work with others. I'm a co-founder of Black Tech Columbus, and maybe we'll talk about some more stuff. But I'm an advocate for giving people exposure to let them know that this industry is for them. So it's a big deal.
That was very cool, Doug. I heard you went to Notre Dame. I actually just took a ancestry DNA test and found out I was 13% Irish. So, you know, go Irish.
All right, go Irish.
And Lorena, last but certainly not least, we could finish with you, please.
Sure, pleasure to be here. So I'm a fellow Nationwider and super proud to have had the pleasure of working with Jermaine in the many years that we've worked together in technology. I'm also a Buckeye alum. So, and my kiddo is now a Buckeye, so super proud of that. Happy to be here at Nationwide. I am the Vice President of the Contact Center and Billing Technology Organization. So hopefully you'll learn a little bit more about what we do there.
Yes, very eager to learn. And congratulations to your son. That is very cool. What industry is he going into?
Information systems, believe it or not, right?
All right.
Information systems, yeah. So congratulations to you. I'll just have to tell him that I just met a fellow graduate. So somebody to look up to.
Yes, thank you. I appreciate the kind words. So we're just going to jump right into the questions. And so this first question is posed to Tammy, Erica, and Jermaine. And so each of you has experienced professional success, and much of that success has been experienced as part of a corporate sector. So also we can assume that you have experienced challenges and roadblocks along the way. It's likely that mentors and sponsors provided assistance along the way in navigating and overcoming those challenges. So if either of you would like to divulge a little bit about those experiences and overcoming those challenges and how you did so, how your mentors and sponsors were important and integral to that, and how it got you to where you are today.
I can dive in first. You know, this is a challenging question because there are lots of challenges that we experience throughout life, but I wanted to go back a little further. Really, I am from, let's go from here. I'm from New York, and I chose to go to school in Arkansas at a predominantly white college in Arkansas. So without me saying any more, you can probably imagine the challenge and obstacles that I experienced attending that university as an African-American, used to the African-American culture, and attempting to survive so far away from home. But I was fortunate enough as a student to have been elected the first African-American homecoming queen, but that did not happen without mentors and sponsors along the way. A mentor who did not look like me encouraged me to not give up when I was ready to pack and go home, to encourage me to continue to go to school and to try to make a difference and to not lose my identity in the process of trying to survive and thrive. And then a sponsor, someone who, as the musical Hamilton will say, was in the room where it happened, was able to talk up some of my better qualities and talk to other leaders about me. And not only did I get that opportunity, but once I graduated from that institution, I was also offered the opportunity to serve on the board of trustees. And that just didn't happen. I was the first African-American female to do that. But when you think about the importance of mentors and sponsors, I certainly could not have done any of that, and even continuing through corporate America, without the influence of those individuals at the door, and then being ready to serve. One of my mentors told me, don't just look for opportunities, but be ready to serve when the door is open. And that's something that I think that we all have to take into consideration. We all want to complain and say, oh, the doors are closed, and it's a glass ceiling, and I can't break through. But then when an opportunity is presented, we talk ourselves out of pursuing those. So I'll just stop there. But I think those are some really keen examples of the importance of mentors and sponsors.
Absolutely. I would 100% agree. And it sounds like you're a bit of a pioneer trailblazer there, Erica. So yeah, that is very cool. And I'm glad that you didn't give up either. So that is a great point, Erica. Thank you. Do we have anyone else who would like to add anything?
Yeah, I'll go ahead and jump in. You know, as was stated, there always are going to be challenges. And you know, one of the things that I have found, especially in technology, in many cases, those of us who are underrepresented in technology, whether it be those who have a diverse background or women in IT, oftentimes are considered for jobs based on what you've already done, not based on what you have the potential to do. And this is why it's so critically important, you know, to understand that perhaps will be a roadblock, but be bold and know what you're capable of, one, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise, right? So don't let yourself be your own roadblock, but rather be confident and capable in what you're able to do. The other thing I would say is, you know, as you think about some of these challenges that we may face in our careers, let your work product and your brand speak for yourself. You know, deliver extraordinary work. You know, I'm a firm believer that every day in your current job is an interview for your next. And so let your brand, you know, really speak for itself and be someone that when they think about you or they think about a Jermaine Henson, they say, that's somebody I want on my team because I know that that person is going to make a difference. You also talked a little bit about mentors and sponsors. And I think, you know, it's important to differentiate the two. Mentors are absolutely critical. You know, you want someone who's going to give you candid feedback on items that you may be doing well, but items that you need to improve. You want someone who's going to coach and develop you and really have your best interests in mind. You know, my experience has been, I'm a little bit more direct with sponsors. You know, I want to know, are you advocating for me? Would you hire me in certain positions? Would you speak up for me at the table when decisions are being made and I may not be there? But one thing that's consistent across both mentors and sponsors is that you have to activate your network with people that look like you and people that don't look like you. You know, very candidly, I would not be sitting here in the position that I'm in today with many of the accomplishments that I've been able to achieve throughout the course of my life without people who were allies for me, who didn't look like me, but saw something in me and invested in me and were both mentors and sponsors. So, you know, it's really important that as we face these challenges and roadblocks, one, be resilient, be bold, understand what you're capable of, activate your network, and ensure that your network of mentors and sponsors represent the diverse community in which we work and live.
And I'd like to add to that too. I think that's perfectly stated because, you know, we really don't get anywhere by ourselves, you know, and I mean, I can speak from my experiences, even from starting in high school, in the college experience and, you know, postgraduate, is that I had a plan. And so I only saw so far just based on, you know, where you're going. So the fact of having mentors and sponsors is to kind of help, you know, kind of bridge that gap everywhere you go. And you'll always have that no matter how long you've been in the field, whether it's 20 years, 15 years, that you'll need sponsors, you'll need mentors, you'll need people to speak up for you in rooms that you're not in, even just because you're not at that level yet to be able to speak. You need someone to know what you're passionate about, what you're interested in, where do you want to take this, and where do you want to go. And then also, in addition to that, you become that person. Just as well as you need mentors and sponsors, you become a mentor and sponsor to someone else. So that basically, that just keeps paying it forward. So yeah, having that mentor and sponsor, an advocate, is key. I mean, for Accenture, you come in the door with, to kind of mitigate that whole roadblock piece, is that you come in the door with a career counselor. You come in the door with the expectation to drive your career, as well as the expectation to reach out to your peers, to reach out to management, to reach out to team members who are on different teams to find out their experiences, so that in addition to you growing, the team grows as well. So it's a collective body of support that, you know, comes from a lot of different places, which helps you grow and helps others grow as well.
Okay, so we will move on to the second question now. So this is for Tony and Carla. And in your positions with PerScholars and TechCore, respectively, a big part of your role is about raising awareness about IT and related careers in IT. So TechCore targeting young people and PerScholars targeting adults. So both organizations are also about the business of equipping persons with knowledge, skills, and abilities they need to consider and or enter into the IT-related career field. So fundamentals to all of that is why IT? And more importantly, when we think about our communities of color and persons from underrepresented groups, why should they consider IT?
So I'll start with that one, since we kind of deal with the younger demographic. So the bigger question is, why not? Why are you not thinking about IT and computer science as a pathway? I mean, sports always comes up, you know, and teaching and, you know, and education and, you know, doctor and lawyer, but IT and computer science are just as integral as anything else. And you can get into those fields and they will transcend whatever discipline that you ultimately land in. So it's a complete launching pad for you and understanding, you know, computational thinking, you know, and just having that type of foundation sets you up for success. It's also an opportunity for you to be creators, you know, and designers as opposed to users and consumers of the technology that we all utilize every single day. And then beyond that, you know, the industry and the world needs you. You know, we need that diversity of thought and representation when it comes to decision making and data sets and, you know, things like that to make sure that, you know, there's that inclusion that the world is founded upon. I mean, so desperately needs. So that would be my answer. And then going back to, you know, just the access and, you know, reaching back, it does put you in the opportunity and the position to be able to reach back and bring others up into the spaces that you were in, because folks before us did not have these opportunities. So it's imperative for us to seize these opportunities when they're presented to us and taking them when they're not.
Yeah, if I can jump in. First, Tony Cunningham, I'm with Prescolis, and Prescolis is an IT training organization that focuses on adults ages 18 and above who are taking a non-traditional pathway into technology. And so they are coming into the industry mostly via industry recognized credentials and certifications, going through intense, rigorous training. And at the end of that process, they would have a certification that they can then go to work with. Most of them end up going back to school and becoming that working adult student the way I did college versus being in college and then launching a career after that. What I would say is why IT is, especially when we think about the adult who may be past that point of graduating high school, matriculating into college, and we are now in a situation where many of the jobs that people could get without a college degree are now being automated. And we have to come up with a way to ensure that we don't continue to promote this chasm between the haves and the have-nots, or people's ability to be economically mobile. And so when we think about why IT for individuals who may be unemployed or underemployed, that's the skill set you need to get in the game right now. And you have to have a way to get those skills quickly. And you have to have a way to be able to economically support you and your family while you are in this continuous learning mode. And learning should be continuous. And so that mentoring and sponsoring is amazing and is important, because once these individuals do get the certifications and different things like that, there needs to be this respect for the non-traditional pathway that they took into the organization. And I would say that when you support these adults who may or may not have been exposed, and then they have children, like the coming out of the households that Carla serves, it creates this multi-generational piece where everyone starts to talk about it and everyone can see themselves as part of it in some way, no matter what discipline, as Carla said, they decide to go into. So why IT? Is because IT is not the future, it is the now. And it's only going to continue to grow. And we have to get more people in the game from communities of color.
Yes, Tony, I think that is huge. And so first, I would like to apologize to you, because I do not think that I called your name to introduce yourself.
Oh, no, I'm good. I would just say that I am a co-founder with Doug in Black Tech Columbus, and I've partnered with Jermaine, and Doug and Jermaine are both on my advisory board for Prescolis. So I'm feeling real good right now in this space with my tribe, but I appreciate the opportunity to be here.
So Doug, this next question is for you. today you serve as the CIO for the city of Dublin, an amazing role, very, very nice city. In addition, you serve as a passionate advocate for people of color, women, and others underrepresented groups to find their way into IT. But that's not necessarily where your dream began. Your first love was music, and that kind of kick-started your career. And so we just kind of want to talk a little bit about how that happened and when you were first introduced into IT, and, you know, your journey of how you got here with us.
Sure. I love music, and I would have loved to have had a very successful career in music. But I went into music because I was good at it, and I knew about it, and I felt like I understood it. Turned out I didn't understand it that well, but I felt like I did. This is actually my third career in IT, and I went to Berklee College of Music. I don't put that in my bio. I don't talk about it. I majored in jazz composition and got into arranging and recording, and my principal instrument was voice, so I sing. But I had two kids, and I was living in New Jersey, and music didn't turn out to be a pathway for me to great success, and I needed to do something different. And I'm really speaking right now to adults who have a self-talk thing. We tend to tell ourselves that IT is some foreign bubble, and I don't know what's in that bubble, so I don't really go in that direction. Just like you said, you think it's either coding or help desk, and you're not interested, no matter what the salary is, you know, and you don't go in that direction. I moved back to Ohio, and I went to University of Toledo, and I did not know what IT was. So I wasn't inspired or wise or creative or smart. I talked to somebody, and I tell people that I got into IT because the pathway was open to me, and it was made very clear to me the steps that I would need to take and what was on the other side. And I walked down that path. And I think we find ourselves with a lot of people of color who don't see a path. You can say there's a career on the other side of that canyon, but if they don't see a way across that canyon, then they're not going to walk down that path. So what I've been told is that my career in music has given me gifts and talents that I can translate into technology and technology work. And I guess my message for other people is that whatever you're good at and whatever you're doing right now, there is a role for you in technology, even if it's just talking or communicating well or planning or organizing or those kinds of things. And if you hate coding, finish the class. There's a great life for you on the other side. So I still consider myself a musician, but in particular, talking to adults who may have kids, who may be the 30-year-old in the college class, who may be embarrassed and feel like, you know, I went down the wrong path, please get that self-talk out of your head. You can have 3 or 4 or 5 different careers. So I'm very happy that I transitioned. And because I've done it once, I would have no problem going into a completely different career. Because you got to get that fear out of your heart.
Wow, that is incredible. And so I have a similar story, and I actually, as you said, I was a little embarrassed to speak on my past experiences up until this point. So, you know, right out of high school, I went to Otterbein College and was going to major in business and was not doing the things I needed to. Flunked out, and you know, for the next 3 years, I was just job hopping without any kind of vision, and not being able to see, as you said, like the forest through the trees. And even though that someone could have told me, like, "Hey, you know, you can do this," like, well, how do I get there? You know, how do I bridge those steps of, you know, talking to another career counselor and maybe school's not right for me, but of really knocking down all those hurdles that people put in front of themselves to open up that door. And so that is really beneficial. And actually, so I've never told anyone, you know, obviously I leave that off my resume, but if that can help someone else, that, you know, it doesn't have to be the first, second, or even third try.
Hey, Garrett, I would ask you to go ahead and tell people that, because everybody feels like I can't go forward and it's not for me and I'm not smart enough. And they look at us in IT as gods on Olympus, and you're amazing. No, you're not amazing. You're a human being. You know, you have stops and starts, and they can too. So when other people have tried college and they feel like there's no other path for them, we have to share our stories with them.
All right. And so, Brandon, looks like we have a two-parter for you. So I will break this up into one question, and then I'll let you answer, and we'll do the second. So a reality for persons of color and underrepresented groups with an interest in IT or already working in IT have a notion of being the only way, the only one way. There's only one way into the department. There's only one way into a project team, only one way to get a degree to succeed in class. And you talked about your experiences and how it served you with both motivation and inspiration. So could you just tell us a little bit about your experiences and advice you have with that reality of taking multiple paths or of having multiple paths being available?
Yeah, it's funny, just to piggyback off the last question and conversation you guys were having. So I actually went to Columbus State. I started out, I was a city kid, south side of Columbus, three-sport athlete. I always thought I was going to go to the NFL with my brother. We both thought we were, so I have a twin brother, Bruce. So this, although this journey is lonely, as you know, being the only black person in a lot of rooms and spaces, I'm fortunate enough to have a twin brother, so it's never lonely. But, you know, I know what it's like to be the only one in the room. But yeah, so, you know, straight out of high school, we thought we were going to go to the NFL, but no one before us was telling us that SATs were required, you know, GPA minimums, all of the cheat sheet things that you should know as you're preparing for the next step, whether that's sports or that's a career, that mentorship, those sponsors to encourage you and give you all of the to-do list things to punch off. We didn't have that. So we ended up going to Columbus State. We still were trying to find a way to get into our journey of being an athlete, to find that pathway to get to the league. And then, you know, so when I was at Columbus State, I was majoring in computer information systems. I was always a tinkerer as a child. In high school, I went to Career Center. And then Career Center is where I fell in love with technology even more, and I went there to get my CCNA. I didn't finish the program because I started as a senior. Had I started as a junior, I would have had 2 years to properly go through that program. But that's where, if you have a roadmap and you have proper mentors, they're able to kind of coach you through earlier versus finding out things way later, right? So that's one misstep that I had. I went to Columbus State, like I said, majoring in computer information systems. From there, I was still chasing sports and not chasing a career, right? So then went to Ohio Dominican, actually joined the football team, played a little while. I thought I was greater than what I was, so I said, I'm going to take my talents to OSU, right? Took my talents to OSU, tried to make the team. I got cut within the tryout. Like, I don't even think the tryout was finished, and I already knew I got cut, right? Didn't even make the list. And my brother was right there. We both went through the same exact journey. At that tryout, I saw how powerful networking and relationships were, because there were people that made the team that never even tried out. So being into systems and being in the right positions at the right time and knowing the right people, you know, that does get you way further a little faster. But because I was chasing sports, I never finished college. I went to Columbus State, Ohio Dominican, Ohio State, and I didn't finish, right? All while still having a focus on, at some point, breaking into tech. I always knew that tech was the wave. It was the wave then. It was going to be the wave now. I always knew it was the future in some aspect. I was going to be around or involved in tech. So long story short, I started there, and I end up on a panel speaking to Columbus State about breaking into tech and being one of the only in a lot of rooms. So we knew then, even going to these events, which is kind of how we started our career, creating a launch pad for people of color and entrepreneurs wanting to find a safe space to be vulnerable enough to break into tech and create a business idea. But for my brother and I, we had to be comfortable with being uncomfortable in all of these spaces. Right. And then so we learned how to then be uncomfortable amongst each other, but then to conquer and divide. So we would always split the room. You know, he would go to the left, I would go to the right. We'd find our way back to the middle. And then we talk about, and we'd always debrief every single event about what I picked up on, what he picked up on. So I think for students and just people in general, it sucks being lonely. But find that one other person that's aligned with you, so that way you can have your twin and you can conquer and divide. You're still going to be uncomfortable, but one other person kind of helps it be that less uncomfortable. So
it looks like we have a late question for Lorena. So it said, what made you pursue an education and take the first step into IT? And can you speak on your background and what drove you to make the decision to that? And what kept you driven and helped you get to where you are today?
Perhaps a unique perspective that I can bring to the panel is perhaps unlike others, I actually grew up internationally. So I grew up overseas. I am Filipino-American, but grew up overseas and went to an international school. And quite frankly, you know, the school that I went to, we absolutely celebrated diversity. And we sought it out. So for me, it was very, very normal. And it was part of my environment day in and day out. Having moved to the United States and getting my education, I missed a lot of that. And so one of the things that resonated with me that Jermaine said earlier is you have to seek people that are like you, but also seek people that are not like you. And for so long and throughout my life, I constantly seek people that are not like me because it is those individuals that make me learn and grow and become the diverse person that I am, to really empathize and really show appreciation for our differences that make us much stronger and more successful. I can say that I'm not an expert, and so being part of this panel is certainly educating me, and so I'm getting more out of it than I bet some folks, you know, that will be listening to this broadcast. But, you know, why I pursued the career that I pursued, I actually was in pre-med. I wanted to be a pediatrician. And something that Doug shared earlier, you know, I was amazing at bio, horrible in chemistry. And I did that self-talk where I just talked myself out of pursuing a degree in medicine. The reality was they don't really check what grade you get as long as you, you know, you pass. But, you know, during that time, it was important to me that I followed through on my commitment with my parents, and my father, you know, and mother were helping me. And the commitment was to graduate in four years and get a degree or head on to medical school. So I had to graduate in 4 years, went to summer school, and I found myself really taking a lot of statistical classes, some information systems courses that were just fascinating, and data analytics was a passion of mine. I ended up graduating with a degree in human ecology because that was the best degree I could come up with based on all the courses I took, right? But at the end of the day, I found my way back home. So a message to some folks, you know, again, ignore that self-talk. You are a rock star and you just have to believe in it. And there are multiple paths to make that happen. But, you know, a key component of that success is because of how I was raised and the diversity around that environment for me. And it's all sorts of people from all sorts of backgrounds. So I'm just thrilled that we're finally having the conversation. I want to continue to be part of it and I want to continue to advocate. It's about time in my mind, right? And in many people's minds. And so this is really enriching for me, and you know, it's something that I think is important for everybody on a frequent basis that just becomes normal and not as intentional. That is my hope. So thanks for the question.
Yes, it's a fantastic answer. So with that, I believe we have one more question for everyone. I would be interested in hearing from those that we maybe didn't share as much as they would like. But as you know, this panel will reach high school students, current Columbus State students, community members, and more. And many of those individuals have been looking into considering the IT field, but are standing in the shoes that we all started in, you know, just that unsure and, you know, it just looking like such an insurmountable task. And so what advice would you give those students, those young adults who want to make the plunge but just don't know how?
Garrett, I appreciate this question because I too am not technically in IT. I'm a talent development person. But it has been amazing to be a part of talent development and workforce development at a time when IT is being moved to the forefront like it is. And it opens up the ability for everyone to participate. And so what I would say to people who are standing back is, 9 times out of 10, if you take an inventory, you're already engaged in IT. If you are taking apart and fixing your own gaming console, if you know your phone doesn't work and you don't want to go stand in line at that darn phone store, and so you like Google and then tinker. If you want something to do, something else, and you like YouTube it and then figure out how to do, you're already in IT. And so don't be intimidated by going to a place where you can learn the theory behind it or some practical pieces that, like you said, Carla, computational flow. And then you won't be intimidated if you really think about the fact that every single day, 9 times out of 10, you are engaging with IT at least 23 out of the 24 hours of a day. And so why not, as Carla said, move from consumer to producer and let it guide you in creating economic mobility for yourself and your family. So I would say jump in with both feet, figure out what gives you joy and go that direction, because 9 times out of 10, you'll find a way to do it in tech, but talk to people and explore. And especially if you're a young person who's just curious about everything. Why? Well, why? Use IT to find out why is what I would say.
No, I just wanted to tag on to what Tony said. And as you're, if you're a young person, as you're saying, I'm not going to be intimidated by technology because I got a pathway into it. Also, don't be intimidated by people in terms of, I'm from this neighborhood in this community. I think you've heard from all the panelists that we've all had to seek out people who were not like us. Please don't go into a career field where you're just comfortable, because I think you hit a dead end pretty quick. Don't say, well, that field is male dominated or there's nobody like me in there. There isn't. And that actually makes you an asset. It makes you more valuable because the differences you bring in, you will be lauded with all sorts of praise just because you have a different point of view. So don't diminish that value and go into something that scares you. So just wanted to tag onto that as well.
You know, I think what everybody's saying is that there's room for so many different people. There's an old African proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. And bring someone along with you in this search or this exploration of IT, because there's truly something for everybody. So go ahead, ladies.
And so my additional comment, and it will be quick as well, Tammy, I promise, is try things early and often. So one of the things that we pride ourselves on with Tech Core is the ability to have programs, you know, that span, you know, very, you know, different topics and things like that, and for various age groups. But, you know, students, you know, you have the ability to try an extracurricular program and see if you like it or if you don't, and it does not impact your GPA, you know, or does not have any type of impact on your academic standing. So seize those types of opportunities that are safe, you know, in supportive environments, in addition to the ones, you know, that will help you academically and, you know, in internships and things like that.
And what I wanted to add is that I love, you know, programs like Tech Core, because basically you get that exposure early. So you get to start to see things early and be able to say, okay, well, you know, how do I apply this to my life, or how do I apply this to the things that I'm curious about? And, you know, and I will share, like last year we had Computer Science Day at the Capitol, and I got to meet some students that were part of Tech Core, and it was two young ladies, and they were showing me their robotics type of apparatus that they built. And then they were talking to me, and they were like, so you're a computer science major, you're a software engineer. And they were like, wow, you look like me. And it was one of those things where they really felt, I never thought that I'd meet someone who was in this field doing this who looked like me. And they were like, so I can do this. I'm like, yes, you can do this. You can do anything you want to do. Like, yes, you may be in a room that's, you know, the only person that looked like, you know, me and you. But at the same time, you deserve to be there. It doesn't matter if you're the only person, if you're the only Black woman, if you're the only, you know, woman or whatnot, you deserve to be there. You have a passion for the field. You have experience. You're curious. So why not? And so having these organizations that also feed, you know, kind of these ideas and kind of supports the narrative of, yes, you can explore all these different fields, you know, earlier on, can help, you know, bridge the gap between high school and college, and then college, and then once you graduate and to go into the field, because you've gotten some sort of exposure to it. So, I felt very proud that day to have the opportunity to bridge the gap of, you're in school now at this level, and you're already building these types of things. And so here's where this could take you. So they may know up until a certain point where I can do this,
and I can build these things, but how does that relate to real world, everyday career work experience? So as a career person, I can come out and say, well, okay, well, you can do this. You can be a mechanical engineer. You can work at Boeing. You can work at all these different industries. You can work for Accenture. You could be an engineer. You could be a developer. You could be a functional resource with the client. So I was able to share my experiences all the way from a developer to the functional world to be able to say, I can speak both languages. And so I can talk through the whole life cycle of whatever it is that the client needs to have done. And so that way they can see where I can take the experiences that I have and my goals and my dreams, and I can apply it to this and do this every day. So having, I think, these organizations, having the, you know, these events like this is very, very impactful because you plant the seed. And from there, they can take that seed and say, well, okay, well, where can I take this? And then as long as, you know, these organizations and people like us can help them see where they can take the seed and how we can help it grow. So I definitely think that's just, it's really impactful to do.
I'll jump in real quick. And I know we're running out of time, but, you know, what everyone has said has been so powerful. And, you know, even though oftentimes we may be the only people that are in the room that look like us, it's our responsibility to make sure that while we might be the only person now, we pave a way for those who come after us so we're not the only person in the future. And I also want to pick up on a little bit of what, you know, Tony and Carla said. We live in a digital world. You know, the young folks who will be listening to this, you are digital natives. You know, you are coming up in an environment where you are interacting with technology all the time. And as you know, I've been around long enough to see COBOL mainframe systems and go to object-oriented development and now AWS cloud-native solutions. But we even are starting to see things like low-code, no-code platforms that allow people to drive technology solutions without being deep developers. And so we just have to understand the evolution of technology is happening at such a pace that we have to be very cognizant of. It's all around us. The technology world and the digital world we live in is now. And we have the ability, like no other time, to use technology to solve real world problems by ordinary people. So don't be intimidated by this technology and don't be intimidated about all that it encompasses. There's so many disciplines and domains that you can consider in this world of technology. And my advice would be lean into it.
And even the fact that we're virtual right now, you know, they're in school virtually. Like, I mean, I 50% used to work remote and 50% travel to a client. So the fact that you're at home and you're, you know, you're learning at home, you're doing all your projects at home, you're collaborating with your, you know, your student, your peers and your teachers, and you're doing all of your assignments at home, that is technology. That is what you could possibly be doing day to day at work. You know, you'll have your meetings where you're, you know, you're collaborating in a setting like this and you're, you know, developing and planning. So it's here now. You're there now already.
Yes, exactly. Exactly, Tammy. So with that being said, if you would like to extend like 20 seconds for each of you, if you have any closing remarks or anything that you would like to add, anything that you felt that we would missed, and that people need to hear. I'm going to start with Tony because I forgot Tony last time and I'm not going to do it this time. So Tony, do you have anything that you would like to add?
In the words of Nike, just do it.
Fantastic. And Lorena, you were last time, not this time. So we'll go with you.
Well, I just would encourage folks to remain open and listen. Simple as that.
Fantastic. And Brandon, we'll continue with you.
I thought Tony was setting the tone, so I was thinking, in the words of Nipsey Hussle, the marathon continues, but I would encourage all students and just even professionals to, like she said, just jump in, remove all fear, unlearn and relearn. Don't be scared to ask a question. I know in the startup space, there is no dumb question, so my brother and I, we jumped right in at that and we asked all the dumb questions we could. If you need an ally or a mentor or somebody to support you on your journey, reach out to any of us. I'm sure we can find someone to help you. Be intentional. Come in with the mindset to give first. It's when you give and you continue to give, you will get it back in return 10x at some point in time. Don't be afraid to pivot. I know everyone's not familiar with basketball, but in entrepreneurship and even in your career field, you can pivot so much that you travel, but it's okay. There's no penalties in pivoting. So, you know, just keep going.
Absolutely. We have to be flexible, especially in this industry. All right. Jermaine, may we continue with you, please?
Yeah, I mean, I really can't add much to what others have said. You know, what keeps coming to my mind is be bold, you know, be brave. Don't let other people define your potential and what you have the ability to do, because I truly believe that you can do whatever you put your mind to. And I just have to say this really quickly, Garrett, since you shared your story and Doug shared his, very similar story. I started out at Ohio State. I didn't make it at Ohio State because I wasn't focused on the right things. I ended up doing a two-year degree at DeVry and working at Nationwide's Help Desk 20 years ago. And then fast forward, I was able to do my Bachelor's of Science in Information Systems as well as my Master's and make it to the level where I can say proudly that I am one of the few vice presidents that are African-American male at Nationwide, but won't be the last. So you can do whatever you put your mind to.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jermaine, for having the courage to say that story. That is fantastic. All right. And Erica, if we could continue with you, please.
Yeah, I would say very briefly, as you pursue talking to the students, as you pursue these career opportunities, define what success looks like for you. A lot of people, as you know, tend to define success as a career ladder where there's only one way up and one way down. A few years back, I wrote an article about your career and the cha-cha slide, because it's more like sometimes you hop forward and you get a promotion. Sometimes you slide to the left and to the right, which is a lateral move. And sometimes you got to go back. And even sometimes you have to Charlie Brown, like in that dance where you just kind of standing in place, but just continue to challenge yourself mentally while you're in place, develop in place, and know that there's always an opportunity to make a move somewhere, somehow.
I love that reference. Even though you're doing the Charlie Brown, it seems you're stuck in place. You're still moving. You're still doing something. So we're never stagnant. I love that. All right. And Tammy, if we could go continue with you.
Sure. I would say to the students, every day, add different tools to your toolbox. Continue to build your skills and have a growth mindset. Ask questions, listen, observe, look at people who, you know, may mirror, you know, success in ways that you're interested in, or just look at people who are in positions that you're in or you're interested in. Ask them questions, jog their mind. You know, build relationships. I mean, everything that we do every day is really truly about relationships, whether it's your peers, whether it's your manager, whether it's your client. So, you know, focus on building relationships, have a plan, and believe in yourself. I mean, you deserve to be where you want to be. So really, really believe in yourself.
Yes, absolutely. Be your biggest advocate.
Be your biggest advocate. Yes. Drive your career, for sure.
Absolutely.
And one of my mottos, I work hard and I play hard. So you've got to have a balance. Have a balance.
Life is all about balance.
It is, totally.
All right. And Carla, I believe you are the last panelist.
I would say be collaborative. You know, like everyone else has said, you know, this does not happen in isolation, you know, or in any type of vacuum. So, you know, be open, you know, to being challenged by others, and feel free to challenge, you know, others as well. And celebrate successes, you know, not only yours, but those of the folks around you, because it's a team effort. You know, it is about the greater collective, for you, for your community, and ultimately for the world.
Yes. Again, I know I've said it a few times, but just thank you all for all your time and for your advice.
Wow, what an amazing conversation. Thank you so much, Garrett, for moderating tonight. And thank you to all 8 of our industry panelists for being here, for being vulnerable, for sharing your experiences with all of us, for sharing your knowledge, and for giving advice to folks in the audience that may be thinking about joining a technology field or degree or certificate program. With that being said, we want to dive into what are some of the opportunities that Columbus State has for getting involved in technology fields. Up next, we have Brian Steele from the Admissions Department here at Columbus State Community College.
Welcome to Columbus State Community College Admissions Presentation. My name is Brian Steele. I'm the recruiter for adult and workforce education at Columbus State. I deal mostly with students who are age 20 and up. That's how Columbus State defines adult students. To my right, you will see our other lovely admissions counselors at Columbus State. Any one of the five of us are always happy to help you with any question you might have. So let's dive right in. I think a lot of people think about Columbus State as just some community college in Central Ohio, but we are so much more than that. We have roughly 27,000 to 28,000 students at any given time. We have students from 135 different countries. We have students from 30 of our 50 states. We have students from 81 of the 88 Ohio counties, students from 156, 188 high schools in our four county service district. And like I said, I mostly work with adult students, which makes up about 68% of our population. So really we have students from a variety of backgrounds, a variety of responsibilities that they have to tackle while they come to Columbus State. And I think our diversity really sets us apart. We do have two full campuses. I think most people are familiar with our Columbus campus downtown, but we also have a campus north of the city in Delaware County. These are fully functioning campuses with classrooms, administrative offices, student life areas. They really are two halves of the whole of the campus life at Columbus State Community College. On top of that, we do have five different regional learning centers surrounding the city. So that really leaves you with seven different locations to attend classes while you go to Columbus State. Currently, we are in a low density approach due to the pandemic, and I will go in more into what that looks like later when I talk about our online offerings and how online courses work at Columbus State. And finally, we have weekend and evening options. Weekend options are pretty self-explanatory, but our evening options go up until 11 p.m. So really we're offering classes almost 24/7 to make sure that we give all of our students as many opportunities to attend classes as possible around their busy schedule. So we have eight different career and academic pathways. We have arts, humanities, and social sciences. We have biological, physical, mathematical sciences. We have business and hospitality services. We have computer science, information technology, and design. We have construction and skilled trades. We have education, human services, and public safety. We have health sciences, and we have engineering, manufacturing, and engineering technology. And within these eight different career and pathways, we have about 200 plus different programs. So anyone coming to Columbus State has a variety of options of programs to study as they pursue their education or going into the workforce. And I always like to point out that each one of these career and academic pathways and these programs have their own embedded academic advisors. So when you are working in your program, you're gonna have a group of experts who are there to help you make sure that you stay on track towards your goal. As you pursue an education at Columbus State Community College, we have two different pathways, our certificate options and our Associate of Science or Associate of Arts degree options. Here's a sneak peek at the different career options within the tech field at Columbus State. I do encourage you to do a little more research at cscc.edu/IT and see if this is the right path for you. In addition to our degree options, we also do have certificate options, and some can be completed in as short as one or two semesters. These are certificate options within the information systems technology field at Columbus State. And you can find a full list of our short-term certificates at the link below. Some examples within the IT field are our business operations analysis certificate. It's two semesters long, and it will provide value-added skills to any management practitioner overseeing a business operation in either manufacturing or service environment. We also offer Cisco Certified Networking Associate Certificates. This is only four courses, and it prepares students to sit for two different exams, the Cisco Certified Entry Network Technician and the Cisco Certified Network Associate exam. So within a very short amount of time, both these certificate programs allow a student to go into the workforce quicker than with a degree program. But I want to emphasize that our associate's degree programs are great, great pathways to a career as well. and also, again, to transfer if that is something that a student's looking to do. And all of our two-year degree programs do have transfer options. We are currently offering grant funding towards people pursuing our in-demand certificates at Columbus State. If you feel like you meet the qualifications on the screen, please feel free to apply, and it may be a way to fund your time at Columbus State as you pursue one of our in-demand certificates. So the median salary for an associate degree graduate at Columbus State is $44,000. Now, high growth fields like healthcare, computer science, engineering, and manufacturing can pay upwards of $50,000, $85,000 for an associate degree holder. So you can make a very, very comfortable living with an associate's degree from Columbus State. And that $44,000 is equal or above what the average bachelor's degree holder makes and without the same level of college debt, because you're doing it at Columbus State and you're paying a lesser tuition amount than you would at one of the four-year schools in the area. What we offer at Columbus State is a very intimate setting to get your degree. Our professors are dedicated to teaching, not publishing or researching. At a lot of four-year universities, professors are required to do research within their field or write academic articles, not so at Columbus State. Our professors are here and their singular focus is to teach you. Small class sizes. Our average class size is 20 students at Columbus State. We have some classes that are smaller, some that are larger. We do not have large lecture hall style classes where you're in the back trying to wave your hand and hopefully get someone to see you and call on you. We don't like having those at Columbus State. We want to make sure that you get as much face-to-face time with your professor as possible. And we offer preparation for success in the workforce and if you transfer to a four-year university. Our academic advising team is going to make sure that you keep on the right path towards your educational goals. We are a leader in online learning. Our students have been working online for a very long time while also having the option to go on ground. Things are a little different right now during the pandemic, and I like to go into that just a little bit. We are in a low density approach to maintain safety for our students, our teachers, and our administration. Most of our classes right now fall into one of two different categories, live online or fully online. A live online class is a synchronous learning environment. So in the past, you may have gone on campus, say Thursday at 7:30. You sit in your desk, you see the professor in front of you, you see your classmates around you, and you begin your class. What we've done is we've replicated that in an online environment using a web conferencing application so that you will, on that Thursday at 7:30, sit down at your computer, but you'll also see your professor, you'll see the students around you, and it'll be a very, very closely replicated version of that on-ground environment, but everyone gets to stay safe. Right now, that is very important. I'm sure we all agree. We also have our fully online classes. Fully online classes are classes that you work through at your own pace. Say you dedicate 8 hours during the week towards your education because you have a busy schedule, and you work through modules or lessons towards that education kind of at your own pace. That is our more traditional fully online format. We do currently do have a few classes that are meeting in person fully. These tend to be classes that fall into different programs that require skills that require hands, such as maybe automotive or healthcare. These classes do meet on campus, but they meet in a very socially distant, safe way. But we also have a lot of classes that are partial in person, which means they're mostly online, but there may be a few lessons here and there that the student needs to go on campus to pass or to learn. And again, it'll be in a very socially distanced, safe way. Safety is so important to Columbus State, and we want to make sure that our students, our faculty, and our administration are all safe. So Columbus State's full-time tuition cost per year is $4,738. That means you can receive an associate's degree for under $10,000, for $9,476. And I think when people see that number and they compare it with what it actually costs to do a full four-year program at a four-year school, as opposed to starting at Columbus State and then transferring in, the savings are really, really evident. So again, Columbus State's full-time tuition cost per year is $4,738. If a student were to pursue a bachelor's degree at a public university for all 4 years without Columbus State, and this includes tuition, room, and board, you're looking at $106,424. A private school would be even more expensive. But if you were to start at Columbus State, get those first 2 years and that associate's degree out of the way, and then transfer into a program you're looking to at a bachelor's, at a four-year university. That bachelor's degree drops down to $62,688. So you're saving over $40,000 by starting at Columbus State and getting a very and getting a very equitable education. Same rigor, same scrutiny held up in the field that you're studying, but you're saving a lot of money by doing it. Financial literacy is a very big, big thing at Columbus State. We want to make sure our students graduate as debt-free as possible. To that end, Columbus State does take financial aid from FAFSA. You go onto the government website, you fill out your FAFSA. This is a document that looks at your finances and basically tells the government, okay, this is the amount of money that they can assist you with when you go to Columbus State. And this comes in a variety of different ways. It could be a grant. Grants are great because you do not have to pay grants back. It can be a loan. Loans do need to be paid back, and they can either be subsidized or unsubsidized. A subsidized loan is a loan that you will not have to pay interest on while you're attending Columbus State. Unsubsidized, you will have to pay interest on while you're attending Columbus State. So subsidized loans are probably preferable. And also federal work study aid. That would be working for the university or you're working for the college and making money towards your education at the time. But Columbus State does have a very, very robust scholarship offerings. We have on average right around 130 plus different scholarships available at any given time. And these are great because it takes one application. Basically, you fill out an application online, you give your information to the school will spits back, okay, these are the scholarships that you may qualify for. And all you gotta do is check the boxes and hit send, and there you go. You've applied to a variety of different scholarships that could be as little as a couple of $100 to a couple of $1,000 towards your education. Most have no financial aid requirements, which is great because that means you don't have to fill out a FAFSA, and that's really great for international students. Many are general and open to all students at Columbus State. And scholarships are available for our certificate programs and our degree programs. So there's a little bit of everything there. And I always recommend that our students give our scholarship website a look, fill out that application. You never know. There's a lot of money that just sits out there that needs to be claimed and used towards our students' education. We have a very strong career services department. And they will start with you as soon as you register for classes. They will put together a career plan for you that time, as soon as you register for your first classes. If you're not sure what you want to study, they'll also help you with major exploration. They'll make sure that you see what all is out there that might be a major of interest to you that could work towards a career that you are interested and passionate about. But we also do help you on the latter side of your time at Columbus State. They help you with resume review. They make sure that when you fill out a resume or when you put together a resume, you're putting down your skills and you're putting down your experience in a way that makes you stand out to potential employers. They'll help you with interview coaching and practice. Interviewing is a skill, and they will make sure that you have enough practice in it so that when you're sitting there across from a potential employer, you're saying the right things and you're really representing yourself best. They'll help you with job search strategies. They'll help you with job postings and federal and college work study eligibility assistance. There's a lot of different ways our career services department will work with you in the end of your time at Columbus State and beyond to get those jobs that you want. So in summary, I really think we are the whole package. Our academics are rigorous and they stand up to the scrutiny of the different fields that we offer degrees in. You will get an education that will benefit you in the workforce. Financial literacy. We want to make sure you graduate as debt-free as possible. Career discovery and planning through our career services department. Social networking and leadership opportunities. And support services and resources through our advising and our advocacy wings. Again, we want to make sure we support our students in every way we can as they work towards our educations. So it's really easy to get started today. You can apply for admission at cscc.edu/apply. There is no application fee. There is no essay. It takes you about 15 minutes online. It's a real quick process. Then we will require either a high school transcript or a GED equivalent. If you have attended college in the past, you'll need to see those college transcripts. And also, we'll need either an SAT or an ACT, or we do offer placement testing for math, actually, A-L-E-K-S. We use a certain math placement test that what we use it for is to make sure that when we are helping you register for class, if you're not familiar with calculus, we don't want you going into a calculus class. We want to make sure we know your current comfortability and level in math so that you really get off on the right foot when you come to Columbus State. And finally, attending a new student orientation. They're all virtual right now. And basically they come in two parts. The first part just lets you know how you can best use your time at Columbus State, the different departments we offer to help you. And the second half is actually an advisor helping you register for classes. And again, all these services are currently virtual. So please contact us. You can reach out to admissions at admissions@cscc.edu or at 287-2669. If you're an immigrant, DACA, or other visa holder, you want to make sure your email iss@cscc.edu. If you're an international student with an F1 visa, you'll want to email istudent@cscc.edu. They're going to make sure to help you with your documentation so you can come to Columbus State. Financial aid can be reached out at finaid@cscc.edu or at 287-5353. And this is a little hint. If you want to reach anyone in Columbus State, that's the best number to use. That's our switchboard operators. They're super knowledgeable. They'll make sure you get to where you need to be. 287-5353. And lastly, if you're active duty, if you're a reservist, or if you're a veteran, or if you're a family member of any, veteranservices@cscc.edu. They're going to make sure to help you with your post 9/11 GI Bill, your yellow ribbon benefits, and just moving into a classroom environment if you haven't been in a long time. They're really there to help you with everything under the sun. And you can reach out to them at 287-2644. I want to thank everyone for their time. That's it for me. And passing on to you, Kaylor.
Thanks, Brian. Hi, guys. My name is Kaylor Ramey. I am the Outreach Program Coordinator here in the Office of Employer Engagement and Experiential Learning. And today brought me in tonight just to talk to you a little bit more about our IT Flexible Apprenticeship Program. And so that's what we're going to do. Won't take us too long, but we're just going to run through it. We'll talk about the eligible majors, about the program itself, and then how you or your students can get started. So the IT Flexible Apprenticeship Program is a program here at the college that we like to refer to as like an earn and learn program. So it really allows students to get some integrated learning in the classroom and outside of the classroom by participating in a paid year-long work study apprenticeship experience at an employer partner. And so it's a really unique program for students in the following majors. So the first one is cybersecurity. Software development, that can actually be the Software Development Associate of Applied Science degree or the certificate or our Data Center Technician certificate. And so what does this program kind of look like? So it does differ a little bit between the certificates and the Associate of Applied Science degrees. Obviously, one is a 5-semester degree path, where the other is a 3-semester certificate. And so for our Associate of Applied Science degrees in cybersecurity and software development, it's going to be 5 semesters of full-time coursework. And within that coursework, they're also going to go through, students go through a series of career readiness and training models. And so in that first semester, it's really just about getting your feet wet in college, getting started for the first time, getting associated with these classes. We actually front load students' technical coursework in this program. So instead of filling their first 2 semesters with general education courses, we really start those technical courses early to make sure that by their second semester, when they go into network and interview with employers, they have some technical knowledge to refer to and lean on to pull them into their apprenticeship. And so in that first semester, we're really focused on courses. We also start a little bit of what we call career prep. So helping students with resume reviews, mock interviews, elevator pitches, a whole gamut of coursework and workshops that really help them become a professional in the space. In the second semester is when we really dive down into that career readiness stuff. So students continue taking their traditional coursework, and then they, you know, are really getting into the nitty gritty of interviewing workshop skills, diversity and inclusion, LinkedIn workshops, GitHub workshops for some of our cyber folks. And so it's really a unique experience that prepares them in every way to go into networking in the competitive interview process with employers in May after their second semester. And so we do throw in a summer semester, you'll notice. So it's a 5-semester program. So in that summer semester, they actually begin work at their work study partner. So they're going to begin their apprenticeship working, 24 to 40 hours a week, depending on the employer. So they're working, they're continuing their coursework. What they learn at work on Monday, they can take the class on Tuesday and vice versa. It really allows them to integrate that learning for the remainder of their degree. The idea being that by the end of the 2 years, they have their Associate of Applied Science in either cybersecurity or software development. They have 1 year work experience under their belt, and then they're ready to move into a full-time role at their employer partner, which we do see about 85 to 90% of our students moving into those full-time roles following graduation. So the best part about this program, I think, is the strong support system you get from both the mentorship on site with your employer partner, you get from career services leading up to that employment opportunity, and you get from our team here at Columbus State with some proactive advising all the way through the program, making sure that you have a single advisor that is dedicated to you in this program, making sure that you succeed along the way. The other big benefit is that school remains number one priority. So our employer partners know that they are hiring students that are finishing their degree, and that this is an opportunity for them to learn the trade before they complete it. And so school remains number one priority for us and for our employer partners for our students. So if you're interested in opposed to an Associate of Applied Science, you're just looking for a certificate or a shorter term option, the Data Center Technician Certificate or Software Development, they operate very similarly. So you would go through interviews in that same timeframe. You would go through the career readiness process in that same timeframe. The only difference is after that summer semester, you would actually graduate with your certificate and continue your apprenticeship from there without those additional 2 semesters of courses because you weren't completing that associate's. This is a really great option. We see this a lot for our career changers or those with a prior degree. So if that's something that sounds like it could be of interest to you, I'm happy to talk about it with you further. So a big question I get is, okay, but this sounds kind of intimidating. What does this interview process look like? So proactive student advising, like I talked about, you're gonna get that across the board. And then getting career ready or leading up into those networking and interviews, we do resume reviews, mock interviews, as many as you need to be comfortable and reach a satisfactory level, an elevator pitch so that you can walk into a room and know how to say, hi, I'm Kaylor, and this is why I'd be a good fit for your company, and explain to the CEO of your dreams in 60 seconds why you should work for them. We do a LinkedIn workshop and then obviously our diversity and inclusion workshops. Like I said, it is a competitive interview process, but before you go through that process, you get a chance to network with these employer partners face-to-face, let them connect a name and a face from seeing your resume, and really give yourself the best opportunity to land that role as an apprentice for a year. So what does the apprenticeship look like? Now that we've gone through the process, we've landed an apprenticeship, what does it look like? So on average, our students are making $18 an hour during their apprenticeship program. That is an incredible wage for our apprentices. I know I always tell my students, I worked in college. I was a Starbucks barista making $8 an hour, I believe. And it, other than teaching me to talk really fast, it didn't set me up for a full-time job. It didn't teach me the skills I needed in my profession, and it didn't help me pay off my student debt. This is a position and a role that would do all three. And so you're going to get that on-the-job mentorship. You're going to work 24 to 40 hours a week, dependent on the employer partner. You're going to get that hands-on technical training in the field as you learn. This isn't an internship where you're going and getting coffee. This is an entry-level position at these employers that really gives you one-on-one mentorship to help you learn these roles. And then obviously you're walking out with the opportunity for full-time employment after this 2-year associate's degree. With these companies that a lot of them will continue to pay through tuition reimbursement for your 4-year degree. So it's a really excellent way to have the opportunity to walk out of school debt-free. I will say that 50 to 60, we are seeing that raise anywhere from 50 to 75 for some of our students walking out. It is a really great way to land in the industry with companies that otherwise you wouldn't get your foot in the door without a bachelor's or a master's degree. And we've heard that from them firsthand. And so once you're in, and it's a great way to continue to grow your career from there. So, you know, some of these benefits, like we said, this isn't just a job. It's an amazing employment opportunity. It's a great employer. Nationwide, Accenture, State Auto, Huntington, T-Circa. There is so many employers that we work with that, you know, are an excellent first job to have on your resume. And they're paying competitive wages for your knowledge and to help train you into the kind of employee that they want to see as you walk out. You're getting that burrito of support. That's a term we've really coined in the past year because between the mentoring on the employer side, the career coaching and professional development, and then the personal holistic wraparound advising from our team here at Columbus State, it really does help support you all the way around in your academic journey. You get to earn while you learn, which is always a benefit. I know, especially for my students that learn better hands-on than maybe just from hearing a lecture or reading it in a book. You know, this is a way to really test the knowledge that you're learning in class on a day-to-day basis. So getting started is pretty easy. Our website for the program is cscc.edu/ITFA. If you haven't already applied to the college, that is always a first step. And so, you know, that do that first. And then once you've done that, the next step is just having a conversation with me. And what we'll do in that conversation is we will talk about your next steps. We'll talk about your career goals. We'll talk about how to get you applied to the program and how to make sure you're going to succeed throughout it and make sure we're getting you that program application and that you're ready for the next steps to come. The other thing I wanted to highlight and just point out to you guys is that we do have some upcoming summer camps for our high school students. So if you are a seventh grader going in or an eighth grader going into ninth grade, or you are a senior graduating this year, you are eligible, that full gamut. So whether you're going into high school or getting ready to leave high school, you would be eligible. These programs are free, but they do require an application. So at cscc.edu/summer camps, most notably, we do have a Gen Cyber Camp and an Alexa Skill Builder Camp that are coming up. Both are bound to be really, really fun and really exciting. And a great way to test, you know, is this really what I want to do? Is this really what I have an interest in? And how, you know, how well do I like it before I join a program where this would be my major? So great way to kind of dip your feet in and get started. All right. So again, thank you guys so much for having me. My name is Kayla Ramey. As I said, I'm happy to chat with you about these programs and help get you started. I'm going to hand it off back to Tom. Thank you guys again.
Thanks so much, Kayla. And with that, that concludes our 2021 In-Demand Jobs Week celebration here at Columbus State Community College. We thank you all for participating. We thank you all for being here this evening. We hope that you learned something new. We hope that you took something away of value, and we also hope to see you again very soon here at Columbus State. Have a great evening.